Introduce Professor Boris Stillman, PhD is in computer science and electrical engineering, and from the National Research Institute of Electrical Engineering in Moscow, and so forth. He asked me to be extremely brief in my introduction. He also is the chairman and CEO and a founder of Stillman. And with that, I'll let you continue. All right, welcome. All right, they're starting, Najib.
Thank you for inviting me for this series of presentations. This is the first one. This is, of course, will be very different from the previous one. I expect this to be technical, it's called tutorial. But I hope to give you all the information needed, so I am not going to rely on something unknown. So, as I was introduced, you probably understand that I'm coming from kind of twofold background as a professor at the University of Colorado and Stillman Advanced Repetitors. Please don't think that this is one-man company. We have about 30 people and really produce important stuff for U.S. defense. So, today's tutorial consists of two parts. The first part will be very application-oriented. I'll try to briefly, very briefly, introduce you to one tool which is used widely by us, by the company, for developing new computer systems in linguistic geometry. Linguistic geometry, by the way, is a type of game theory which I developed, and then the company developed the technology based on this game theory. And so this will be the first part, how to map a real-world problem into this game environment. And it is important because this theory permits to solve our complex, typically intractable problems in near the real time, in real time. These problems are extremely complex, like managing the battlefield, managing, predicting courses of actions for all sides of the conflict, actually solving military games. So, this, the first part will be very, very practical, in a sense. The second part will be, I would say, very theoretical. I'll try to explain the essence of linguistic geometry by removing all the formulas, almost all the mathematics. Will be mostly pictures, and I hope to kind of rely on your intuition in that sense. So you could ask me questions during this presentation, and I'll be happy to answer during the talk. So, the first part, constructing games. The second part, solving games. The solving games are also an example, very, in a sense, simple example. So, constructing games. Again, if you're interested in Deeper Account, this is the book which was published a long time ago, and you can read a lot about this, but it's certainly out of date, because it was published in 2000. The tool which I referenced already is called LG Package, LG Linguistic Geometry. It consists of several instruments, I would say. Game development kit, game integration kit, and game model interface. So, as I said, you have to take the real world problem and map it into the linguistic geometry definition. Definition of so-called abstract word games. And that's what is done employing this tool. Then again, solving tools. Of course, it would be very hard for me to go into details. And so-called hyper-game control. So today, I'm going to emphasize just the first instrument out of this set of tools, which is called game development tool. The simplest part, how to make this map. So, these are some major components of this paper. the this linguistic geometry is completely discrete. So the environment of our world is continuous, at least at the macro level, I would say. So we have to map the continuous environment into the discrete game. How to do it? That's what I'm going to emphasize today. The other stuff I would just briefly mention. So, what is this discrete definition? What are these abstract word games? When we are talking about these abstract word games, you should think always about the game of chess. If you play chess, you should always use your images, your intuition about chess, because it's very close and it's part of this. So the main part of this definition, and this where what is the abstract word game is, this a tuple, is this triple. So what do we have? Finite set of points, which is kind of simple. Think about chess, 64 squares. That's what it is. Set of elements, black and white, piece of one, piece of two. Of course, there could be more, so in here I just simplify more. And the most interesting part, relations of reachability, where every piece can move, rules for movement, which means in here, for example, piece P can move from location X to location Y, which means that Y is reachable from X, which is again very, very simple. So when you have this triple, other stuff can be easily derived from this. And this is a very general definition, and it appears that all, practically all the military problems can satisfy that. Of course, this definition is not, it's not very hard to give this definition, it's much harder to solve this. What does it mean to solve? In here, what is really defined, the set of target states for one side, set of target states for the other side, and they of course compete with each other. So what would be the optimum, according to some criteria, variation, which leads to win or loss, and whatever it is, how to find the optimal solution? Typically, it is considered intractable problem for more or less non-toy size problems. And all the military problems are just not toy problems. So what was solved in here, what was shown in here, that for many problems, for many real world problems, it is solvable. I'm not saying it generates optimum, but it generates satisfactory solution, which is in many cases much better than human solution. So let's assume that we want to follow this plan. We want to introduce, to map our problem into the discrete environment. So we have to discretize space, discretize pieces, and discretize movement. Space probably the easiest, supposedly. So we can introduce, for example, this rectangular grid, so that piece could move, and what linguistic geometry would understand just the coordinates of this square, or whatever this cell is. And we could mark so-called reachabilities, which squares are reachable from the current square. And probably that's it, that's how we could do this. But there is one simple problem. If you look at the distances, for example, from here to here, it's one step and two steps. And what is the distance from here to this location? One, two. So diagonal is equal to the sum. Of course, it's far from real world. So we have to fight this error. What can be done? That's the simplest approach to introduce hexagons. Of course, it does not remove this problem completely. The smaller the diameter of this hex, the less error will be. But that's the approach. So it makes errors less, but still it stays. So on two-dimensional surface, you could introduce this text. What can be done in 3D? It would be great to have something like a hex in three-dimensional space. But it is well known by geometers and geographers that in three-dimensional space you cannot fill three-dimensional space with such a right shape like a hex. No such shape exists. So you have to sacrifice something. So that's what we did. Vertically, we introduced this as a grid, and horizontally as a hex. So it's a hexagonal rectangular prism. And this actually satisfies practical needs. So these hexes could be different sizes, depends on the type of the problem. For example, for aircraft it will be one size, for the infantry another size. It could be even this kind of discretization with these spheres. Again, depends on the specific problem. So it's all doable. Now, what if we are going to solve problems which are related to the entire planet? For example, missiles, satellites, and so on. The whole surface of the planet could be covered by this hexagonal network. This is done by geodesians, by geographers already for many years ago, for different purposes, specifically for geography. But the same ideas and the same techniques was used for us. So all these are cells. Of course, their diameter would be different, depends again on the specific problem. It could be very fine grid, it could be a much coarser grid, it doesn't matter. The construction of this grid is based on the geometrical shape called icosahedron. By dividing this icosahedron into triangles, you can make very fine grid. And that's how it was developed. Now about piece discretization. It seems it's simple, so probably one aircraft is a piece, and infantry man is a piece. On the other hand, there could be a group of aircraft as a piece. And this piece can be broken into several pieces when they separate from a close proximity and so on. So it's not necessarily one entity, one piece. Now movement discretization. Of course, this is related to introducing reachability. How can we discretize movement? That is very simple. Let's make a snapshot of the situation, like a taking picture. And let's assume our pieces are right there. Let's take time interval, for example, 30 seconds, and make another snapshot. And in another 30 seconds, get another snapshot. So this is discretization. We consider making these snapshots and see where pieces move. And in time increment can be 1 minute, 30 minutes, or even maybe 1 day. Again, depends on the scope of the problem. Based on this discretization which I mentioned, we can formalize all those notions, like velocity, acceleration, gravity, and so on. How? The idea is very simple. Let's assume our aircraft is in this cell, whatever shape of this cell, X or maybe a three-dimensional prism, it doesn't matter. We can ask the pilot, where can this aircraft be within one time interval, for example, within 30 seconds. So let's assume that pilot would mark these blue cells. So this is reachability. That's what we formally define. That's where this aircraft can reach within one time interval. But there is one complexity in here. There is notion of speed or velocity. So this aircraft may arrive in here, but it cannot have the velocity vector pointing in this direction. It may be only in this direction. So how to deal with this? It's actually yet another dimension we have to introduce. So we have to deal with, not with just 2D or 3-dimensional space, but essentially the phase space. So phase space takes into account the direction of this velocity vector. So that's the size of the space. For example, with the hexes, it would be just 6 different directions. So direction space times 3-dimensional space of hexagonal prism. It's just one of possible approaches. But we can increase the size of the phase space and take into account different parameters, not only the velocity vector. And yet another complication, I would say. In linguistic geometry, there is no notion of straight line. It's just sequence of squares or sequence of cells. And straight line is comes from the real world. So how, but if we want to have a line of sight, for example, for shooting, we need the straight line of real world. So how to map these straight lines into this discrete world? Again, very simple. So let's assume that this is our initial, and this is what it can hit within one time interval, for example. So let's assume that this is the building of some kind of, or some kind of another obstacle. And we can say that those locations are not reachable within one time interval, like a shadow of this obstacle. So this tells us that this is some kind of straight line or simulation of straight lines. Of course, this is a very rough approximation. And we worked with this for some time, but probably about 5 years ago, we introduced actually two models. The real physical world model on top of this, specifically to compute three-dimensional line of sight, and of course the tactics, the courses of actions were computed employing linguistic geometry. Why can't we use just normal physical models? The problem is, as I said, it's intractable. If you start just computing with precise physics, you won't solve it in a lifetime. So what our interest is to find strategies. So whatever is necessary to generate strategy must be used. Everything which is secondary must be neglected. What about these factors? Typically, especially in the past when I gave presentations, they ask how do you deal with incomplete false information? How do you account for weather, enemy deception, imperfect sensors, and so on? All kinds of imperfectness of the real world. The point is that employing this approach, employing linguistic geometry, you can generate courses of actions in real time and update those courses of actions in real time. So we can recalculate once new information comes through sensors. So what really happens? Let's assume that we have so-called world views. This is blue world view. It is the vision of the world of the blue side. Of course, they have some kind of notion about the world. We can also assume that the red side, the enemy, also has its own world view. And it's usually different from the blue world. Because they have their own intelligence, their own notion. So these two world views are different. But we can model them and generate courses of action, assuming every time that this is the real thing. And once the operation starts, or simulation starts, doesn't matter, there will be obvious that there are discrepancies between these two, especially if real world operations start. And based on those discrepancies, you can make corrections to those well views. Of course, there is true well view, but it is usually unknown. This is called the first level of reflection. But let's assume we can construct something more sophisticated. We can construct what red thinks about what blue thinks. The first level of reflection. And then red, blue things, what red things about blue. And these levels could go higher and higher. All those well used could be modeled and played against each other. And the final for this, probably the notion of so-called hyper games. Those abstract four games which I briefly introduced, these are representations of one game. But it appears that real world operations are so complex that one game, even theoretical, is insufficient to represent a real world operation. One. Imagine you have operation which involves a tank and a missile flying. What would be the speed of this missile in comparison with the speed of the tank? How would you map this into one game? Because tank would move and, for example, 1 minute it would come from this location to the next. But missile will appear and disappear. And there won't be real involvement of it at all. So this is very simple objection of having one game. So probably we need two different games. One for the missile and another one for the tank. But they must communicate. There are many other problems with having one game for the whole operation, besides resolution and speed. So this is very simple example of so-called hyper game. So three games which are shown in here represent one hyper game. This is the space game which covers the entire planet with the resolution we can see with the diameter of the cell 300 miles. This is naval engagement with the resolution 100 miles for the cell, and this is 2 miles air battle over this island. I'm not sure if you recognize this island. This is Taiwan, by the way. So what is important in here? Looks like these three different games, but the point is with linguistic geometry, it considers this as one game. So all the recomputation happens automatically. And for us, we see this as three games. To LG, it is one. And it allows us every event which happens in one of these games immediately inputs events in the other games. And here they cover kind of different areas, but there could be hyper game which covers exactly the same area. More than that, nowadays we have kind of modification or new advancement that every piece can live in its own time. So it happens in its own game of the hyper game. Why is it important? Because in LG, everything is whole, only whole numbers. But if your speed, for example, 3.2 miles, how would you deal with the entity which whose speed is 3 miles? That's where you can introduce its own time. So every entity moves in its own time frames and in its specific speed. This, I probably won't talk about this much. These are kind of old events of the 90s, so-called effects-based operations, when operations should be planned based on the remote effects of these operations. Typically, military cannot plan operations based on the remote effects. In this case, they just bound Serbia and that's it. Of course, not expecting exactly what will happen in the end. But based on the hyper game approach, this also can be solved. And this is a typical example, I would say classic example of the hyper games. It's well-known battle Overlord of D-Day. So you can see I will show the games of the hyper game which are involved. The first game, Allies Cross English Channel, it is shown right there. The second game, Allies Fight on Normandy beaches, and without other games of the hyper game, they would suffer big losses. But another game shows supply railroads routes for German troops. And another game of the Hyper League, Allied force cut German supply by destroying Marshall Islands in Belgium. So all this is one Hyper game, but they don't appear at once. Eventually they will come at once, but kind of the system builds those games one after another. And these are also all the events, because this stuff was developed, as I said, long time ago. This is when Iraq was the enemy under Saddam Hussein and was threatening Kuwait constantly, and actually Boeing asked us to develop an optimal approach to defending Kuwait. It was 2001-2002. So that's how it looks at that time, with a discrete representation of Kuwait, and that's how the Hyper game for defending Kuwait looked like. Okay, so this is very brief introduction, as I said, into a game construction, but I still want to make it a little more transparent for you. So, to give you a flavor of these tools which are used for automating all this. So, there is a movie which is posted on the web, a very old movie which is called GDK, Game Development Kit, and I'm going to show you a clip from this movie. Just 4 minute clip. If you want, you can look this 20 minute movie for yourself. So, and it is, it will be self-explanatory. Actually, it is narrated.
Next, we need to define movement properties for the pieces. In linguistic geometry, this is done using so-called reachabilities. Note that there are some exceptions, such as ballistic missiles or satellites, for which reachabilities cannot be easily specified. Movement abilities for such pieces are entered differently, as will be shown later. Let us now demonstrate how more common reachabilities are defined by entering one for the blue fighter. We first enable the 3D line of sight computation to check for obstacles, then the first reachability data is added. What you see now is representation of the local space around the piece. By clicking on the hexagons, you can specify the relative locations that are reachable from the central location in one game mode. This reachability was provided by an aircraft pilot who was asked, if you are in an F-18 in the central cell flying north, which of these cells can you be in 30 seconds, given that every cell is 2 nautical miles across? Note that the end directions are also specified. This is done to differentiate between moving to the cell in front while still facing mostly forward, or ending up in that same cell but facing backwards, which is basically impossible. Similarly, this location with this direction is also unreachable, since according to the pilot, given F-18's airspeed and turning radius, he could only move to this location by flying along this curve, so he would be facing south or southeast. Locations directly behind the aircraft cannot be physically reached in one game move with any end direction. So far, we have only entered information on the same altitude. However, this is a 3D model. We also need to define how the aircraft can ascend and descend. This can be done using the side view to switch the different planes relative to the aircraft's position. By entering the same pattern on a level above and a level below, we allow this aircraft to maintain the same horizontal movement abilities while going up or down one layer of the game board. We could, of course, define that the aircraft's horizontal velocity changes based on whether it is moving up or down. In addition, we are not restricted to only defining one reachability pattern for this type. For instance, this pattern will be used at altitudes of up to 1200 feet above sea level, while a different one will be defined for higher altitudes. Note also that any size reachabilities can be defined by changing the size of the local space representation in both horizontal and vertical dimensions. According to the subject matter experts, at higher altitudes, the aircraft can accelerate to a boosting velocity. Therefore, another reachability pattern is added that is set represents high velocity flight, however with decreased maneuverability. Note that the reachability for going down a layer is the one with the regular velocity again, to signify that the plane has to slow down when moving to below the 10,000 feet level, as boosting is not allowed there. Two more batteries were defined to link low altitude regular speed and high altitude boosting reachabilities. The resulting total reachability is then assigned to the blue fighter. Similarly, the reachabilities for all the other mobile pieces were defined and assigned. For example, this is a reachability for a subsonic cruise missile. As you can see, it flies at about the speed of the aircraft, however, it is much less maneuverable. Let us proceed by defining the weapons. The weapons are defined in the same way as pieces, by specified visualization.
So, I think you realize how we did this done. Just in this short
previous.
So this is the end of the first part. It's too early to make a break. So let me start the second part. It is very, very different. This was almost a game between us and between you and me. But now I would ask you to kind of focus. Because while the presentation will be very simple, but still a lot of ideas will be present into this. So, soaring games. Let's assume that we have a game, micro game, but I will show everything on this very simple example. If you ever played chess, you probably heard about this problem. It's called raising and game. Why is it so interesting? Actually, this is Richard Reiting. He was Czech grandmaster. And he invented this endgame in 1921, so almost 100 years ago. What is the problem in here? So you can see there are two kings, white king and black king, and two pawns, white pawn and a black pawn. So black pawn, of course, will try to reach this location each one and get promoted into black queen, and white pawn also will try to promote it. E8. And those kings, of course, will try to prevent those events. So, what is so special in here? It appears that, just on the first glance, that this black pawn should easily reach this location, get promoted, and probably the black should win. And here also, this black king would easily intercept this pawn right here or immediately after promotion. So it's almost obvious, black must win. The trick and the funny thing is that there is a pawn. So black cannot win. For any chess player, of course for amateur it's hard, but for any chess player with some rank, it's not this problem. The problem is how to solve this without search or without huge search. Typically, what computers do and what how it was planned in the beginning of computer era. Search through all combinations in here. What does it mean? Let's assume that, for example, king stands somewhere in the middle. How many legal moves does this king have? For example, it is here. So here, here, here. So it will be 8 legal moves in any direction. And if pawn, another pawn, of course, should have just 1 legal move. So it will be, on average, 9 moves for white, 9 moves for black, on average. To solve this problem, you should search at least to the depth of 12. So the search tree will be 9 to the power of 12. Nowadays for computer is nothing. It's about a billion. the problem and how can you scale this? If your problem is not that simple, but something close to real world problems, how will you do real search? Because in here, 9 to the power of 12, this billion is doable. Actually, when this research started, even this was not really doable for computers of this past era. But nowadays, of course, it's not. But again, it is not scalable. If you heard about, chess champion Garry Kasparov, and he was defeated by a computer in 1997, the whole thing was based on brute force research. Of course, it was parallel search, all these tricks, cut off the tree into multiple pieces, but it was still a search, a huge, huge search. And it suddenly is not scalable. And the problem, the military problems I mentioned, the search is absolutely astronomical. For example, some of the problems we were involved with the company, the search would be 10 to the power of 50,000. It doesn't matter if for the game of chess the search is 10 to the power of 120. It doesn't matter if it's 120 or 50,000. It's still astronomical. It is not doable. So the question is, how do humans do that? How do they solve this problem without this search, practically without search? Multiple experiments show that grandmasters and highly skilled chess players search max 100 moves. 100, so 10 to the power of 2, not 10 to the power of 120 or 50,000. Which means they don't really search. It's because it's not a search. It is something else. And that's what linguistic geometry does, and that's what I was involved for many years back in the former Soviet Union, trying to model the approach of grandmasters. And based on this, we developed this theory of linguistic geometry. So today I'll try to explain the essence of this. I did not understand this essence for many, many years, despite we had this program, we had a lot of results, but to explain what helps us to solve this question. So today I'll try to pass this to you. This result actually was obtained in the end of the 90s. So just read this. I hope this name, John McCarthy, is familiar to you. He is considered to be a founder of the field of artificial intelligence. Of course, this is a relative title because a number of scientists were involved in this, but he specifically talks about this entity. It was actually posted on his webpage in the end of the 90s. And when I actually wrote the book on linguistic geometry, I found this and included this quote in my book. I sent the manuscript to him, and I was waiting for 1 month, then asked him, have you received it? The response was exactly. And that's it. So I didn't get anything in response, essentially. But it doesn't matter. So, I'll try a little bit reformulate this problem. It's the same problem. So what do we have in here? Let's call it the bomber, and this is white bomber and black bomber. And this is white fighter and black fighter. These are actually kings, and these are pawns. It's the same rules as in the game of chess. So this bomber, again, I try to simplify a little bit and make it more formal. So this bomber will move straight vertically, one step at a time, to hit this in model time. I don't want promotions, just to hit this target. Same thing for this white bomber. It will move straight ahead and will try to destroy this in model black target. And these two fighters, this black fighter, of course, will try to intercept this white bomber. before it hits, it started or immediately after that. The same thing for this white fiber. They move exactly as kinks in any direction, one step at a time. Also, white fiber can protect this white bump. If white fiber is at any location adjacent to this white bomber, we can say that the white bomber is safe because the total protective power of weapons of white fighter and white bomber is sufficient so that the black fighter would never even try to destroy it. It's the same, I reformulate the chess rules, right? So, as I said, it's almost obvious that black should win, because this white fighter is so far from this black bomber, and black bomber can easily and safely reach the target. And here, white bomber of course close to the target, but black fighter is also close to here, and it would be able to intercept this before it hits the target or immediately after that. So, a win for the black. So the question is there such strategy? And I wrote here optimal strategy. So let's assume that we are talking about strategy, meaning optimal strategy. Such that both bombers hit their targets on subsequent time increments and stay safe for at least 1 minute. So both bombers hit, this will hit and this will hit, and to this safety. This is one type of draw. Is it possible? Another type of draw, both bombers are destroyed before they hit their targets or immediately after that. So we don't care which one. But the problem is that no matter what black does, this must happen. Either this one or this one. On the first glance, it looks unbelievable. How is it possible?
Excuse me, maybe I missed the point. The plane, the airplane, can interact with each other?
They don't approach. Which one? Of course, this plane should approach and come to the location of this point. Then it's considered destroyed, like in chess. This does not approach this one, because once it approaches this, on the next move, I didn't mention, one at a time, movement is here, like in chess. So a white fighter would never approach the black fighter in the adjacent location. Otherwise, of course, white fighter can approach white bomber to protect.
And they can interact and make a collaborative strategy or something like this or not?
No, interaction doesn't mean collaborative strategy,
yeah.
But strategy is collaborative.
Okay.
So
they can
white, of course, white have their own strategy, black have their own strategy. So. But they, of course, do not collaborate between enemy and camps.
Of course, of course.
Yeah. So, this is a formal representation of this problem. Again, on the first glance, it is very, very simple. On the other hand, it is very complex. And it is not by chance that McCarthy mentioned this. So, what is the solution? Of course, I want to tell you, so you were not moving in the dark. The white fighter should move diagonally. This one. Right here. No matter what black does, white fighter should move diagonally. And then at some point of time, depending on who actually moving, black fighter or black bomber, it would have enough time either to deviate to here and support white bomber in approaching safely the target, or deviate in this direction and intercept black bomber. So that's the strategy. It's not obvious.
May I ask a stupid question?
Yeah.
Would that be applicable to drones interacting with each other in order to maximize their effectiveness?
It's a complex question.
Okay.
It's, of course it is applicable, but the specifics of this is serial movement. One at a time movement. And drones move concurrently. Unfortunately, there is no ready endgame for concurrent games. Otherwise, it would be great. I proved this also, especially in this book in particular. So, concurrency kills ready endgame. But they call it wrong steel cross. Okay, so now just summarizing different approaches. I mentioned this so-called brute force search. Let's assume this is the start state, and these are goal states or terminal states right here. And this kind of tree. Where does this tree come from? In the current state, you have, for example, 9 moves, as we discussed. For every move, there is a 9 responses. For every response, another 9 responses. So that's how it is usually shown as a tree. So it grows exponentially. And that's typical with the base of 9. But in the game of chess, usually it's not 9, it's typically about 36, 40 legal moves. So it's 36 times 36 times 36, that's how it goes. And this is what is called brute force. As I said, it's not doable for real world problems. Unfortunately, it is done for chess with this blue, deep blue, how it is called, this program, and many subsequent chess programs by brute force. But in real world, as I said, time required for searching through this exceeds lifetime. So you would never, it doesn't matter what kind of computers we use, even quantum computers won't work, because numbers are huge. Humans do something like this. What do? They just take 1 or 2 moves. How? What they consider good moves, consider 1 or 2 responses to these moves. And then 1 or 2 responses to responses. How do they choose these so-called good moves? That's the point. That's what we try to simulate and actually develop a theory based on this. Of course, there are some mathematical tricks which actually reduce this tree. It's called search reduction. But if your so-called branching factor is not 9, but for example, 1 million, for example, this doesn't help at all. It just increases the depth of the search, but it's still exponential. So real world problems cannot be handled with any kind of search reduction. The point is we have to avoid search completely. You probably, if you try to read about this somewhere on the internet, you won't see that. Now it is very fashionable to deal with, especially now with big data, with big searches. All the powerful computers will handle this, no way. No way, it is not scalable, no matter what kind of computers and what kind of data we will use. So that's what we try to understand and monitor. Many years ago, by the way, exactly 40 years ago, in 77, our program, back actually in Moscow, solved this endgame with this search tree. So from left to the right, this is algebraic notation. For example, this first move h8 to g7, so this is from h8 to g7, and so on. So from left to the right. You can see the tree is very small. It's not a billion. It's not 9 to the power of 12. It's actually about 50 moves. And what you see in black, actually optimal strategy. There are some branches, because it depends on how black moves. But you can see all the black branches marked with 0, means the draw. Plus 1 in favor of win for the for white, minus 1 in favor of black. And all the bold lines marked with 0, these are terminal values of terminal states, which means the winning the optimal strategy is draw. But it did so. So the theory which I kind of try to explain right now did not exist at that time. The program existed. So the point is to understand why this is optimal. Of course, there is a procedure in mathematics called minimax on the tree. So if you perform minimax, you will see that you have actually to propagate this terminal values to the top of the tree, and 0 will come here, which means these are bold branches are optimal branches. But in reality, to prove optimality, you have to construct true search tree, brute force search tree. Only optimality on this tree would prove that this is the solution. So why are we sure that this is optimal based on this very simplified minimax and on this small tree? The only judgment we used was the judgment of experts. Of course, a lot of chess players, you would ask that they would tell you, yes, this is the way I would solve this problem. So actually, it looks a little strange, but in reality, in majority of real-world problems, this is the main response. Why do we think that this is the solution? Because human experts would approve. Because the real optimality is not known. The scale of the problem is such that neither of mathematical tools can handle it. So the only judgment is judgment of the expert. If you think about military problems, exactly what is happening there. Experts, if experts approve this solution, it is good solution. In many cases, they are lost completely. That's the other situation. But in majority, you know how this wars are played or performed by humans. So their judgments or judgments of advanced commanders are considered optimal or nearly optimal. So that's what we wanted to approach, the judgment of human experts. But this problem is so simple in terms of in mathematical sense that it is possible to solve it without search, employing linguistic geometry techniques, and simultaneously prove optimality. What would it tell us? It would kind of, we would be able to make backward judgment that tools which are used are not coming from people. You see, they do. They are not coming from somewhere, but there is some foundation in there. Which means that if they give optimality in simple cases, we are actually talking about class of problems, probably there is something fundamental in those tools. Because the actual source, initial source, are human expert approach, initial source of those tools. But once I can just solve the problem and simultaneously prove optimality without search, employing these tools, there is something special in them. So today I'll try to explain those tools to some depth.
When you talk, I suppose that I can ask more stupid questions, because especially because I left, you see?
Yeah.
When you are talking about judgment, is something by analogical thing related to expert systems?
Not really.
No, not really.
No, not really. Not really. Expert systems are very limited.
Yes, I know.
They try to solve
this is
problem.
Why I use the word analogical.
Yeah. No, it's not.
No, it's not.
No, it's not. No, it's not. So again, you've seen this slide already, and of course the game of chess is a very simple example of those abstract board games. We have just two pieces. We have the 64 squares board, and we have reachabilities for the king and for the pawn, actually for black and white. Now, the main notion of this whole approach, which would look very simplistic to you, I'm sure, once you start analyzing that. Let's assume that this is our white piece, P0, this white circle, is going to move along this path and destroy this target Q4. So this is black piece and this is white piece. So it moves to here, then to location 3, to location 4, and then hits the target. Very simple, it's called main trajectory. Let's assume that these two black pieces, Q3 and Q2, are going to intercept this P0 at this location 4. In what way? For example, P3 would come close to location 7 and wait while this P0 appears at location 4. Then it will move and destroy. Same thing can be accomplished employing P3, also to location 5. These two trajectories for Q3 and Q4 are called negation trajectories, or first negation trajectory. They negate the main trajectory. Let's assume that P sub 1 right here already at this location, and when Q2 appears at location 5, P1 would move and destroy it at location 5. This is called second negation trajectory, but at the same time there is a trajectory of PQ1 of the black trajectory, so that Q1 will come to location 0 in attempt to try to protect Q2 from being destroyed by P1. So that if P1 will destroy Q2, Q1 will punish, destroying Q1. So maybe in such case, P1 won't even try to do that. So in a way, Q1 will try to protect Q2 from being destroyed by P1 and so on. So these are first negation trajectories, Q3 and Q2. This Q1 and P1, second negation trajectory, this is third negation and so on. The length of those trajectories is in agreement with the length of the main trajectory. In what sense? So that all those pieces, Q3 and Q2, should have enough time to approach this location. So they won't come, would never come if it's too late. Assuming that P sub 0 does not skip moves. So it's quite term, and we assume it's serial movement and upper movement. So those trajectories are generated on the assumption that interception will happen, guaranteed. Same thing with all these high negation trajectories. So the whole structure is called the solver. It's kind of a historical name for us, but we use this term all the way, all these years. So, what is so special about this? And why we could call it some kind of a language of games? So that it's probably hard to imagine that you can introduce several types of zones. P sub 0 should come here and block the trajectory of some other zone. Domination, so that P sub 0 would come to this location 3 and wait. When some other piece and some other zone would go through, it will destroy it. Or it will prevent this piece from coming here. So it will dominate this location. And there are two types of simple zones, and unblock. And that's it. So in the game of chess, that's what we have. Just five types of zones. It is a little strange that all the combinations of the history of chess, 200, 300 years ago, all the future combinations, could be explained in terms of these five zones. So it's like elementary particle of the game of chess. And all kinds of opposing games also could be described this way. Moreover, once we started analyzing military operations, they also have all these zones, of course, are involved. But the total number of zones is about 10, no more. And all the tricks, you can imagine all the tricks of the past, would be described in terms of those zones. So, this is, we could call it language of linguistic geometry. It is not the language in the form of mathematical sense. I would call it a pictorial language. What I was doing many years ago, I mapped those pictures into formal mathematics and actually constructed formal languages, and that's why it's called linguistic geometry. It is geometry, you see this. This is obviously geometrical stuff. Of course, it's not Euclidean geometry, it's different geometry. But it is geometry. But what I've done, I constructed special languages and completely mapped this into those languages.